Rarely, there are serious adverse effects of the COVID vaccine. You probably have heard of the Miami doctor who died shortly after getting the Pfizer vaccine. I made a video about that already, but since that video, I've learned some new things about that case in an autopsy report, which I'll talk about in my next video. But for this video, I'm going to look at the overall benefits versus the risks of the COVID vaccines. Now, particularly the mRNA vaccines Pfizer and Moderna and the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. The mRNA vaccines contain a tiny piece of mRNA, messenger RNA, that tells the cells of the body to make some proteins, in this case, antigens. These antigens then stimulate the immune system to make antibodies that specifically become ready to attack the antigens of the virus. So these mRNA vaccines make the immune system get to work in a very specific, targeted manner, much like a precise missile strike. Now, on the contrary, when a virus infects you, it's like a bomb goes off within the immune system. Things are chaotic and messy. And this is why immunological processes like Guiilan-Barre syndrome, myocarditis, and immune thrombocytopenia, these are all immunological processes that are actually worse when you have a viral infection. So you get a viral infection, and then these things can happen as a result of the immune system sort of going haywire. But they can also occur after a vaccine is given, but it's less likely to occur with a vaccine compared to a virus. The vaccines can also cause other immunological processes, such as allergic reactions. Sometimes the allergic reaction is so bad that it causes anaphylaxis, which is a life-threatening condition. So what are the odds of developing a serious adverse event after COVID vaccination, such as GBS, meaning Guillain-Barré syndrome, or myocarditis? And how often have people died as a result of the vaccine? Let's take a closer look, and we'll start with anaphylaxis. From December 14th of 2020 through January 18th of 2021, there's been a total of 9.9 million doses of the Pfizer vaccine and 7.5 million doses of the Moderna vaccine that were given in the United States. Now, the CDC identified 66 case reports of anaphylaxis during that time, 47 of which were after the Pfizer vaccine, so that gives a reporting rate of 4.7 cases per million doses administered. For Moderna, there were 19 cases, which gives a reporting rate of 2.5 cases per million doses. So of all these cases of anaphylaxis, the number of deaths was zero. So the chances of getting anaphylaxis from the COVID vaccine, it's about the same as the chances of you getting struck by lightning over the course of the next year. And the chances of dying from a lightning strike are way higher than the chances of dying from anaphylaxis from the vaccine. As of July 22nd of this year, there's been 187 million people in the U.S. who received at least one dose of the COVID vaccine. Close monitoring of safety surveillance has demonstrated that serious adverse events after COVID vaccination are very rare. One medical condition that has been reported in people shortly after they received the vaccine is something called thrombosis with thrombocytopenia syndrome, or TTS for short. It's also known as VITT, meaning vaccine-induced thrombosis with thrombocytopenia. So thrombosis means blood clots, and then thrombocytopenia means low platelets. As of June 30th of this year, there have been 12.6 million doses of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine given in the U.S., and of those, there have been 38 cases of TTS within 15 days of getting that vaccine. So that's about 3 cases per million doses given. Now, of the 38 cases of TTS, 4 died. The groups that had the highest rate was that of females aged 30 to 49, in which in that group, there are about 9 cases per million doses given. And something that I would want to know is how many of these women were on birth control, because that in itself is a risk factor for getting blood clots. Another condition is Guillain-Barre syndrome. It's a rare autoimmune neurologic disorder characterized by weakness and sometimes paralysis. So some cases have been reported after the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. Within that VAERS reporting system, 100 reports of GBS after the Johnson & Johnson vaccine were received during February 27th to June 30th. So the GBS reporting rate was 7.8 cases per million vaccine doses administered. Among subgroups based on the sex and age, the reporting rates of VAERS was highest among males aged 50 to 64, with 15.6 cases per million Johnson & Johnson vaccines given. And of all the 100 cases of Guillain-Barre syndrome, one of them died. And then there's myocarditis, meaning heart inflammation, which there have been some cases after the mRNA vaccines, mostly in young males. So as of June 30th, 141 million second doses of the mRNA vaccines have been given to those age 18 and older. Now, within VAERS, there were 497 reports of myocarditis after the second dose. So that's 3.5 cases per million second doses. Now, in the subgroup analyses, the reporting rate was highest among males aged 18 to 29, which was 24 cases per million. And there were no confirmed myocarditis-associated deaths. Now, some might say, well, what about the 13-year-old boy in Michigan who died presumably of myocarditis after he received the Pfizer vaccine? Now, that was a public case, and so far we don't have the reported CDC numbers for the 12 to 17 age group available. So the Pfizer has been approved for 12 to 17 ages based on studies showing its safety. And now, just published in the New England Journal of Medicine, the Moderna vaccine has been shown to be safe in that same age group, 12 to 17. So in summary, overall, when it comes to these three vaccines, the groups that have a slightly higher risk, it's going to be men aged 50 to 64 who get the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. They have a slightly higher risk of developing Guillain-Barré syndrome. Then there's the women aged 30 to 49 who get the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. They have a slightly higher risk of developing TTS. And then you have males aged 18 to 29 who have a slightly higher risk of myocarditis after the mRNA vaccines, and this probably extends to age 12 to 17. So how do the risks compare to the benefits of the vaccine? The vaccines are very effective at preventing or mitigating COVID illness, especially when you talk about preventing COVID hospitalizations and deaths. These benefits far outweigh the risks of anaphylaxis, Guillain-Barré syndrome, TTS, and myocarditis. In the U.S., the total number of deaths estimated to have been prevented by the vaccines, 279,000. Most of the vaccines in the U.S. have been Pfizer and Moderna. And this is easy to realize when you see that 99% of those who are dying from COVID are unvaccinated. For the J&J vaccine, for every million doses given to males aged 50 to 64, that's 1,800 COVID hospitalizations and 140 deaths that could be prevented. Now, that's compared with 15 Guillain-Barré syndrome cases and one or two TTS cases. Also, the COVID vaccine benefits are actually being underestimated because the analysis did not include potential benefits of preventing long COVID and post-COVID conditions. For example, people who developed myocarditis as a result of the virus and not the vaccine. Based on the CDC ACIP's conclusion regarding the benefit-risk assessment on July 22nd, vaccination with any of the available COVID vaccines in the United States continues to be recommended for all adults, in addition to Pfizer for the 12 to 17 age group. So Pfizer, Moderna, and Johnson & Johnson, but for the 12 to 17, so far it's just Pfizer. And based on the new New England Journal of Medicine study, you can soon expect to see Moderna get an EUA for that age group as well. The Delta variant is the most contagious variant yet, and with kids going back to school soon, this will be all the more important. About 94,000 kids got COVID-19 last week, which made up 15% of all new cases. But does the Delta variant make children more prone to having more serious COVID illness? So far, it's not really clear. Less than 2% of all child COVID cases required hospitalization. So far, vaccines for kids are still in clinical trials, so we'll see if the benefits outweigh the risks.